It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go. Take a look at 5 and 10, glistening once again, with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas, toys in every store. But the prettiest sight to see is the holly that will be on your own front door.
Hey, welcome everyone to our Roaring Readers Winter Program. Today you are going to hear some fabulous musical productions by some of our kindergartners and our first graders. You'll be hearing today Feliz Navidad, sung by our kindergartners and first grade. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Kindergarten is going to be singing that one. And Jingle Bells will be sung by our first graders. You're also going to be getting some ideas for reading resources. Our kindergarten team has put together some wonderful online resources that over the break, parents and students are able to access. You can also use it during the school year as well. We're going to be reading a couple of stories to you tonight as well. We've got The Smiley Snowman, and Mrs. Wright, our kindergarten teacher, is going to be reading that. And in first grade, it's going to be a story called Hurry Santa, read to us by Mrs. Wanorowski. Our first grade team is also going to give our parents some tips about story elements, things that you can do at home with your child to really help your children when reading a story. So enjoy this evening, the performance, enjoy the presentation. We're wishing everyone a very Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Christmas. Hi, boys and girls and parents. We are so proud of all the work that your students have put forward this first half of the school year. As a part of Roaring Readers, your kindergarten teachers would like to provide you with some reading resources that you can do with your child at home. If you have access to the internet by computer, tablet, or a smartphone, your kindergarten teachers will be sending home a list of apps, webs, and websites that could greatly benefit your child. These apps are meant to strengthen their skills in letter and number recognition, letter sounds, and to begin blending words. These apps will also benefit your students who are learning the English language. In addition, we will be including a link as well as your students' login information so that they can access the Lee County Library at home. Exposure to reading is so important at this age, and we hope that you find these resources helpful. Happy reading and happy holidays, boys and girls.
Hi, boys and girls. Today we're going to be listening to the story The Smiley Snowman, written by M. Christina Butler and Tina McNaughton. As I read, I want you to listen to the different characters in our story and the special things that they do. I also want you to listen and see if you can determine what the setting of the story is. Remember, setting is where the story takes place. Here is The Smiley Snowman. The snowman was nearly finished. Little Bear and Small Fox lifted a big snowball onto his huge body.
"My turn," cried Fluff Bunny. "Let me help."
"Come on then, Fluff," giggled Small Fox. "We can't leave you out." "Here we go," cried Little Bear, lifting him up, and Fluff gave the snowman a great big smile.
"Yippee!"
squeaked Fluff. He looks really happy now.
"Hello, Snowman."
"Let's go, Fluff," shrieked Little Bear, and Small Fox sliding down the hill.
"But what about Snowman?" Fluff called.
"Don't worry, Snowman. I'll stay with you. What shall we play?" So together they played snowballs. And Fluff showed the snowman how to do headstands. Then he told stories until the sky grew dark and the snowflakes began to fall. One by one, tiny lights started twinkling in the valley below.
"I have to go now," said Fluff. "Night, night, snowman. See you tomorrow."
Next morning, the new snow sparkled bright.
"Wait for me,"
gasped Fluff as he bounced up the hill after Little Bear and Small Fox. But the snowman looked sad and shivery.
"Oh no," whispered Fluff. "What's wrong?"
"He looks cold to me," said Little Bear.
"He needs a hat."
"I'll get a scarf," cried Small Fox. And off they went to see what they could find. "This will warm him up," giggled Little Bear as they pulled the woolly hat and scarf into place.
"What's happened to Fluff?" asked Small Fox when they finished.
"I don't know," replied Little Bear, "but there's something very strange coming up the hill. Look."
"What can it be?" asked Small Fox.
Hiding behind Little Bear, a big floppy thing with lumpy bumps was shuffling nearer. Suddenly, Little Bear laughed.
"It's Fluff," he yelled. "He has a blanket."
"Hold on, Fluff, we're coming." Together, the friends pulled the blanket up to the snowman. Then they tucked it around and pulled it up and wrapped it around again. Until only the snowman's big pebble eyes were peeping out.
"He'll be nice and cozy now," said Little Bear.
"Come on, Fluff. Small Fox has a new sled." So they went skimming down the hill. With snowball fights on the way up and down, they went again until Fluff was quite tired out and flopped back on the sled.
"We'll pull you, Fluff," laughed Little Bear. Let's go and see Snowman. But something was wrong. Drip, drip, drip. Drops of water were running down the snowman's face, and there were puddles of water everywhere. "Our snowman's sinking," Fluff yells. "He's melting," cried Little Bear. "We have to make him cold again." They pulled off the blanket and threw Snowman's hat and scarf in the air. "Don't worry, Snowman," cried Fluff. "We'll save you." "More snow, more snow," shouted Little Bear as they padded and packed and smoothed and padded. Soon, the snowman was bigger and better than before. "Wow," gasped Little Bear. "We nearly lost him." "But why does he still look so sad?" puzzled Fluff, staring up at the snowman. Fluff stretched his arms as far as he could around the snowman's big body. "What's wrong, snowman?" he asked gently. "Please don't be so sad." "Look," whispered a small fox, "something's happening." "He's smiling," cried Little Bear suddenly. "Fluff's done it," shouted Small Fox. "Snowman wasn't cold on the outside. He was cold on the inside," Fluff grinned. "He just needed a hug." And as the stars twinkled in the clear night sky, they gave the snowman another hug, and his happy smile grew bigger than ever. And that's the end of our story, boys and girls. I hope you enjoyed the smiley snowman. Have a wonderful rest of your evening.
Today we are here to talk about ways that you can help your children read stories at home. So the first thing I'm going to discuss is characters. When you're reading with your child at home, you can ask them about the characters in the book. So when you're reading with your child, ask them who the character is. The character is usually a person, a creature, or an animal in the story.
You can also talk about the setting with your child. The setting can be when or where the story takes place. So your child could answer with, "It happened long ago," or "It happened in a forest far, far away." The setting can also change as you read the story. It could start in a school and end at their house.
You can also talk to your child about the events in a story. So the events are what happens in a story, and they're the most important details. So you can have your child sequence these events: what happens first, next, and last, what happens at the beginning of the story, the middle of the story, and the end of the story.
As you're talking about the characters, setting, and events, don't forget the illustrations. The illustrations in a book have a lot of important details that your child can discuss with you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Mrs. Wonorowski, and I'm going to model a read-aloud to you to illustrate the standards that we're teaching first graders at Spring Creek Elementary. This is a narrative story, so when you read a narrative text to your children, we'd like you to focus on the story elements, which are the setting, the characters, the events. Stories have problems and solutions. And then there's a central message. And every time an author writes a book, they have a reason why they're writing it. And we want children to make connections with the story so that they can learn from the stories that they're reading. So this story is called Furry Santa, written and illustrated by Julie Sykes and Tim Warnett. Hurry, Santa. Were you ever in a hurry, boys and girls?
Mm-hmm.
No, you were never in a hurry?
No.
Aren't we in a hurry every day? I have to teach you this much. And we have this much time, so we're always in a hurry.
Yeah.
Right? And Santa has a big job to do in a little bit of time. So he's in a hurry too. Hurry, Santa. Now, we focus on illustrations. We focus on the details in the words and in the pictures. So when you're reading with your children at home, we want them to study the pictures and look for clues in the picture. I'm going to try to show you the whole picture as I read. It was Christmas Eve, Santa's busiest time of year. But Santa was fast asleep, snoring under his blanket. Let me hear you snore. That's what Santa was sounding like. Wake up! Squeaked Santa's little mouse, tugging at his beard. Hurry, Santa, you can't be late tonight. Do you see a little mouse in this picture?
Yeah.
What would it feel like if someone was tugging on your face? You don't have beards, but if they were tugging on your hair, you would say, ouch! And that's the next word. Ouch! Cried Santa, sitting up and rubbing his chin. Oh, goodness! Is that clock right? Do you see the clock? The alarm didn't go off, and I overslept. Raise your hand if you ever overslept in the morning. Sometimes that happens, and what do you have to do?
Wake up!
I have to hurry, because you don't want to miss the bus. So, let's see what happens to Santa when he hurries. Oh, no. Can you see what he did?
Yeah.
Look carefully at the illustration. Can you see what might happen next? Look at his pants. Here's a pant leg, and here's a pant leg. Do you see a foot here?
Yeah.
How many feet do you see here?
Two.
Two. Did you ever do that? Put your pants on like that?
Yeah.
When you do that, what happens? When you
try
to walk? I think so. Let's see. Santa leapt out of bed and began to pull on his clothes. He was in such a hurry that he put both feet in one pant leg and fell flat on his face. Oh, no. Now, the words tell us that he fell on his face, but the picture isn't showing that. It's just showing the two legs and one leg. So sometimes there's information in the picture that's not in the text, and sometimes there's information that's in the text and not in the picture. So that's why it's really important for children to study the illustrations and listen to the words, because you pick up a lot of details that way. Did you see the little mouse?
Yeah.
I don't know if you can see that, but he's holding his eyes like that. Oh, no. Hurry, Santa. So far we have the characters are Santa and the mouse. And I see a little kid there. What's the setting of the story so far? Timber?
His little hut, I believe.
The setting is where the story is. Oh, you said his hut? Is that what you said?
I think he has a little hut.
A hut? Oh, okay. And in his little hut, what room do you think they're in? So they're at Santa's home in the bedroom. Okay, so they're at Santa's little home, wherever he lives up at the North Pole. Okay, hurry, Santa, meowed the cat. You can't be late tonight. No, I can't, agreed Santa, getting back up. I can't be late delivering presents. So now we have the little mouse. We have the cat, and we have Santa. Now they're not inside anymore. Where's the setting now? Mason? They're at the North Pole, and are they inside Santa's house? Adam?
Outside.
They're outside. Santa's looking for something. You know what he might be looking for?
Oh, I know.
Dylan?
His sleigh?
His sleigh? It looks like these are things he might use on his sleigh. Let's read to find out. When he was finally dressed, Santa hurried outside to his sleigh. Yay! He picked up the harness and tried to put it on the reindeer. So if you didn't know what a harness was, it's in the picture. But the reindeer weren't there. Oh, no! Where could they be?
Maybe they do.
Do you see another character coming into the story?
Yeah.
That is a fox. And the fox is telling Santa something. Those are the quotation marks that tell us what fox is saying. The reindeer are loose in the woods, called Fox. You better catch them before they wander off. Hurry, Santa, you can't be late tonight. No, I can't, agreed Santa. and as he ran toward the trees. So there they go, looking for the
reindeer.
Oh my goodness, there's reindeer there, all right. Deep in the woods. So now they're, where's the setting now? Marlene? In the woods. Good job. Settings change throughout stories. You have to pay attention. They help you understand better. Look at all the details in these illustrations. Deep in the woods, some of the reindeer were having a snowball fight.
Ah!
Shouted Santa as a snowball hit him in the face. Do you see the snowball hitting him in the face?
Yeah.
So we have reindeer. It looks like they're having fun, doesn't it? I could tell by their little smiles. So they're not fighting, they're playing. Okay, hurry, Santa hooted owl. Here's another character, the owl. When animals talk, what does that tell us? Is that fiction or nonfiction? Nonfiction. This cannot, this is not, or this is fiction. This could not really happen. Animals don't talk, right? Okay, this is fiction. Hurry, Santa hooted owl. You don't have time to play in the snow. I wasn't playing, said Santa. He searched all over for the other reindeer, but they were nowhere to be found. Oh no, I hope you four could pull the sleigh by yourselves. He said, come on, we have work to do. So usually there are 8 reindeer, but Santa only has 4. Do you think that's a problem?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's half. He has half as many reindeer as he needs. At last, Santa finally took off, steering the sleigh toward the moon. Go, reindeer, go, he shouted. We can't be late tonight. So now they're leaving the North Pole in their, you know how we travel around the world in Google Earth to visit different places? Well, he's traveling all around the world with his 4 reindeer. Around the world they flew, delivering their presents. Down again, called Santa, turning the sleigh toward a farm. Hurry, Santa, answered the reindeer. We're miles from anywhere, and the night's almost over. I'm doing my best, boomed Santa, flicking the reins. Do you think he's going to make it?
No.
Let's see what finds out what happens. Uh-oh. I could tell by the look on Santa's face. Something bad's happening. What do you think might be happening? Here, let's see. Yes, he was trying to land, and I think he's having a crash landing. Before he knew what was happening, the reindeer quickened their pace. Quickened their pace. What do you think that means? When you quicken something. The base word is quick. What does quick mean? They were going really fast. They were going really fast. Whoa, Santa cried, but it was too late. Landing with a bump, the sleigh skidded crazily across the snow. Oh dear, cried Santa, another problem. He's running into lots of problems. Let's just go back to the beginning and look at the problems. What was his first problem? Do you remember? Jaylen. He was late. The alarm clock wasn't working. He was late. And what was the next problem? What happened next? Yes, he put his pants on wrong and he fell. And then the next problem, you're ready?
He couldn't find his sleigh.
He couldn't find his sleigh. They said he couldn't find his reindeer. They were busy having a snowball fight in the woods. And then he crashed. And this word says crash in big capital letters. So when you see words like that, it means you have to yell it. Yell crash for me.
Crash!
Yes, crash. The sleigh had gotten stuck in a giant snowdrift. Santa scrambled to his feet and rubbed his bottom. Nothing's broken, but we have to keep going. He's struggling, isn't he?
Yeah.
Yes, he is. So let's see what happens. Can you tell what Santa's trying to do?
Yeah, I can tell.
What's he trying to do with the sleigh, Marlene?
He's pushing it.
Yeah, he's pushing it. And you can see the reindeer are, what are they doing? Are they pushing or pulling? They're pulling the sleigh. They're struggling. When the reindeer untangled themselves, they tried to dig out the sleigh. They tugged and pulled and pushed as hard as they could, but the sleigh was completely stuck in the snow. They're somewhere on a farm in the middle of nowhere, stuck in the snow. Another problem. It's no use, wailed the reindeer. We can't move this sleigh on our own. Do we ever give up, boys and girls?
No! Never.
We must keep trying, said Santa. The sky is getting lighter and we're running out of time. We have to hurry, hurry, hurry. Suddenly, Santa heard a loud neigh. What says neigh? What animal says neigh? A horse, can you neigh for me?
Neigh!
Neigh! That's what they hear. Look at the size of this horse. He's huge. Trotting toward them was a very large horse. Hurry, Santa, she neighed. You still have presents to deliver. I'll help you move your sleigh. So they all pulled together, even Santa's little mouse. But it was no good. The sleigh was still stuck. Do you see the teeny tiny mouse pulling? Everybody's working together as a team, just like we do in our classroom. Hurry, Santa, called the rooster. You see the rooster from the barnyard? It's nearly morning. I am trying to hurry, puffed Santa. One more pull, everyone. And everyone pulls, and at last the sleigh began to move. Yay. I hope this is the last problem. And Santa tumbled backward, cheering. The picture shows he tumbled. The words showed he tumbled, too. Hurry, Santa, called all the animals. The sun's rising. You have to finish your rounds before the children wake up. Yes, agreed Santa. It's nearly Christmas Day, and he still has lots of toys to deliver, doesn't he?
Yeah.
He does. Okay, it was a close call, but by dawn, Santa managed to deliver every present. Finally, he and the reindeer arrived back at the
North Pole.
That's where we are now in the story, at the North Pole. We did it, yawned Santa. I wasn't... He stopped. He sees another problem. Do you see the problem?
Yeah.
Do you see, does anybody see a problem in their picture? Domingo? There is a present. He stared at his sack in dismay. At the very bottom was a present. How awful, I've forgotten someone. But I noticed, why would the animals be smiling when Santa noticed a problem? Let's read to find out. Then Santa saw that all the animals were laughing at him. That present is for you, said the reindeer. It's from all of us. Hurry, Santa, added the little mouse. You should open your present. It's Christmas Day. Yes, I should, chuckled Santa. I wonder what it is. Can you think of what might be in that tiny box? Think for a minute. What could it be? Think about what the author is trying to teach us and something that Santa might need. Abraham, what do you think could be in that box? What did you say?
I think you said it's a clock.
Did you say clock?
Yeah.
What
yeah.
were you thinking, Marlene? Cookies? Mm-hmm. What do you think, Timber?
I was thinking something that you really, really needed that would help him with all of his problems.
What's something he really, really needs that would help him with his problem?
A clock?
A clock.
A new clock.
What do you think, Jalen?
That.
That's your Jalen. A clock. So, everybody seems to think it's a clock. I think you know narrative stories and how authors think when they're organizing, because the problem with his clock, and stories always end with a solution to the problem, and you guys were right. It was a new clock. Boys and girls, let me see if it's the last page. Yes, it is. I have a round of applause for you. You figured it out. Can you tell me, why do you think the author wrote this story? There's probably a couple of reasons, but let's share our ideas. Why do you think the author, what did he want? What's the central message? What did he want you to learn?
I wanted to learn to not wreck.
To what?
Not wreck.
To not?
Wreck, like crash.
Crash, to not crash. Okay, so do you know why he crashed? He was
struggling.
And why was he struggling, Abraham? He had a lot of struggles, all because of one thing. Does anybody know?
I know. His reindeer.
It was his reindeer's fault? Did the reindeer self-bomb cause it? Well, it was. Kind of, they were out playing in the woods when they shouldn't have been doing that. Remember?
He was such in a hurry because he was so late.
Yes. Very good. So it's important to have a good clock to wake yourself up on time so you're not late, so you won't be late for school, you won't be missing the school bus, you won't be late for wherever you have to go, to parties. It's important to wake up on time because when you do that, you have a wonderful day. You start your day off right. Awesome. Boys and girls, you did a really great job on this story. Thank you. And thank you, friends at home, for joining us. We hope you have a happy, healthy holiday season. Thank you.